So has the Associated Press here in the United States. We told you years ago that Facebook tracks everywhere you go. It's 800 million users in real time. It's not just cookies. They have other tracking systems. They got caught last week and said, it's a mistake. We're sorry. Remember, the founder, Zuckerman, called you a bunch of dumb effers. He said, our customers trust us. They're a bunch of dumb effers. Well, the same top Australian technologist who discovered they were tracking everybody, we already knew it, but great, he just rediscovered it and did get this attention on it. Just like I told you that OnStar was tracking you 12 years ago, now it's admitted and Bill O'Reilly took credit this week. Great, I don't care who takes credit. The same technologist who discovered this went and dug up the patent. You can find this on all these companies. Google put out a patent 6 years ago we covered. And the patent, show you a document cam shot of this, says that they track everything you do in real time once you come to the site and you leave it. And again, I'll show viewers a document cam shot of this. U.S. Patent and Trademark Office, it's patent number 20110231240. And of course, there's a patent number and a press release put out by Google in 2005 admitting they're listening to you with the onboard microphone on your computer and that a computer is logging everything you say and then putting into a psychological algorithm package. They even say if a dog barks in the background, they'll then have dog food ads pop up. And I told people this 6 years ago, even though we had the press release and the patent on Google and people didn't want to believe it. This because, oh, it's impossible. That's Big Brother. Now they just throw it in your face. So there is the patent. We also have the Sydney Morning Herald breaking all of that down. So I thought that we would just go over that for you this evening. Next little tidbit. Today, I was looking at drudgereport.com and I saw an article that had just come out of CBS News that Starbucks wants to help you. They're going to pressure in trendy pressure. Just like the other stores say, hey, you want to give money to this charity or that charity, and it turns out the store is keeping generally about 75% of the money. Just like United Way got caught keeping, along with Red Cross, billions of dollars, it was several billion, of 9/11 first responder donations and giving it to gun control groups, anti-family groups. As soon as I saw the name of this group, I called Paul Watson and I said, I remember seeing this group connected to trying to get Obama elected, to socialism, to gun control. And because they said, we're not just going to have you give $5 and then these development banks loan it at interest. You got to love that. To people locally. It also said they help community groups. And turns out it's connected to Starbucks in 2008, saying they were going to donate part of every purchase to Obama and his campaign. That's how the article ends. The company also offered free coffee to those who offered to pledge their allegiance to Obama's creepy National Civilian Security Force proposal, with the kids in red uniforms dancing around like going, huh, we're taking over, huh, I'm fierce, socialism. And so now when the trendies go in, they'll have the trendy behind the counter go, you got your tall, which is a small, want to give $5 to help small business? How about you cut taxes? How about you cut taxes? Seriously. They're in there laughing, making me laugh. No, it's sad, actually. Sure, I'll do one for people. It's trendy. Would you like to give $5 for small businesses, give them jobs? And if you're like, no, I just want whatever you're putting in this coffee that's so creepy. I'm like, oh, you're not trendy. All right, there you go. I'm sorry. All right, it's not that funny. It's actually sad. And then you give the money, and they're going to give it to gun-grabbing groups and national service groups with youth in red jackets and khaki pants going, huh, brigade, force, socialism, huh, get your guns. Huh. I mean, this is how you're going to get jobs? How about, it's not funny, dude. How about we cut taxes on small businesses? How about we enforce the federal law that most of these federal contracts are supposed to be given to small businesses, and they're not? Turned out they're all blacked out, and foreign companies get it. There's a blacklist. How about we do that? No, you've got to be lectured by a trendy to give money so they can give it to a gun grabber. So there you go, and let me tell you, it's going to be a huge success. The trendies will be like, oh, shit, God, oh, my God, ooh, liberal, ooh. I mean, it's just, it's true, dude. All right, God, here's Christian Science Monitor. Starbucks to customers, donate $5, create jobs. I mean, Why don't you just go give a small business $5? This is the biggest load of horse crap I have ever seen in my life. I mean, Starbucks ruining all these local communities, coming in, selling their overpriced, trendy crap. And now they're going to lecture you and demand $5 to give it to Sovietization groups. Tell you, Wall Street's behind the communist and socialist folks. They love taking the money through government, paying it corporate welfare to themselves. That's it. I'm officially, I've told people at the office, and they really do it, don't buy Starbucks coffee and bring it in. Don't, I've told family, please don't buy it. Yeah, it's strong. It'll wake you up. It'll wake the dead up and then make you wish you were dead a couple hours later. But I'm here to tell you, no more Starbucks. I'm boycotting you, the NFL, all of it. I've had enough. Now, let's continue here. And the TSA. You're like Big Brother giving me stuff to say in there. Dude's the master controller. He's actually Colonel Ziegler. All right, and the Vatican assassin commander. All right, continuing. Continuing. All right, now I'm screwing around too much. Let's get serious here. Guys, stop it. ESPN. No, first I got to get to Gibson Wood. Oh, yeah, here it is. Gibson, the feds have now demanded they hand over the rest of their wood, even though India admits it was legally bought and is not in short supply or endangered. But they don't care if polar bears have gone from 10,000 to 50,000. They say they're endangered as they, you know, invade Canada. That's the same thing here. They just want to harass an American-made company that's non-union, and that's the end of it. So feds demand 25 more bundles of Indian wood from Gibson Guitars. We're going to get the CEO back on the show here. Now, let's get to our next little tidbit here. Speaking of guitars, it's Hank Williams Jr., everybody's favorite hillbilly. And I guess a country boy can't survive when he went on Fox and Friends a few days ago. And the media said that he called Obama Hitler. So I watched the whole thing, and Rob watched it, and I said, what do you think, Rob? And Rob said, no, he was saying the whole government stinks. He said, I don't like any of the Republicans. He was asked, he said, I won't vote for any of them in the full club. He said, 89% of Americans in the USA Today want to abolish Congress. Well, how about abolish the crooks that are in there? I've seen polls of 91%. Only 9% actually approve of Congress. So it's worse than Hank's saying. And he says that it should be polar opposites, Netanyahu and Hitler, in his view, you know, to have the Republicans and Democrats meeting. He doesn't like the socialist health care takeover that's admittedly bankrupting people and increasing health care prices. And for stating his political views, he's fired from 20 years of introducing Monday Night Football. And again, the real reason was not going after Obama, but going after the whole system and saying people are fed up and angry. They want to send a chilling effect. You get up and speak out against the government, you're going to lose your job, whether it's the Dixie Chicks against war or a good old boy that doesn't like the Congress and doesn't like Obama. The message is you sit down and shut up or you're going to lose your job. And I don't like the fact that Hank Williams III came out and, you know, said his dad wasn't you know, smart enough. In fact, let me give you the exact quote here. I've got it here in my stack somewhere. He came out and said, my dad should not talk politics. He told CMZ, he said, most musicians are not worthy. Everybody's worthy of speaking out and saying what they believe. He said only Jello Biafra is Pope powerful enough to be able for us to speak. So, you know, I think you should stick up for your daddy, Hank III. You look just like your granddaddy and got some good music. I think you guys ought to get back together and stop fighting with each other. And you should be friends with Shooter as well. But that's all a side issue. Little inside baseball. The point is, let's go to the heresy, the blasphemy of Hank Williams Jr. This is the rest of the story. He said the whole political system shot. That's what he's being punished for.
An easy question. Who do you like in the GOP race?
Nobody. You remember the golf game they had, ladies and gentlemen?
Yeah.
Remember the golf game?
Boehner.
That was one of the biggest political mistakes ever.
Why?
It'd be like Hitler playing golf with Netanyahu, okay?
Okay.
Not hardly. Look at USA Today poll. 89% said Congress should be completely replaced.
Mm-hmm.
I agree with them. You know, the health care bill left, it's not going to fly either.
So he doesn't like any of the Republicans, and he said even more. You can watch the whole interview on YouTube. He said 89% of Americans say replace everybody in Congress. So I guess he actually got that right. My memory was he was saying abolish Congress. And he went on to say that these two people should be polar opposites and not like each other. We're not supposed to have the political process where it's two parties acting in concert like two birds, two wings on the same bird. No teleprompter, folks, so there's going to be little foibles and mistakes. Now, I want to go to this very informative and interesting Man on the Street interview that Darren McBreen did down at the city council with some people. And then he's going to be down there Thursday covering the Occupy Wall Street events in Austin. I'm going to be in Dallas Friday night, Saturday in Houston, Sunday in San Antonio for our Occupy the Federal Reserve. And Rob Jacobson, our reporter, has been sent to New York. We got correspondents everywhere, thanks to your support, up there covering really the epicenter of this. But we're really trying to gauge who the Occupy Wall Street people really are versus who the media says they are. Because the media says they're our saviors, the communists, who want to redistribute the wealth to offshore bankers with a tax on the middle class. And we talked to people in New York. Jacobson's got the interviews where they're like, I don't care about the $27 trillion of the Federal Reserve. I want to raise taxes on people making, $200,000, $300,000. Yes, that will fix it. So it's more a class envy, class warfare situation. A lot of folks don't understand that when you knock out the middle class, people don't have money to come buy your goods and services, and then you don't get into the middle class. You like burn the ladder that leads upwards or blow the bridge that takes you to the greener pastures. But the bankers know how to manipulate. That's why they're trying this. So there's a fight over the heart and soul over where this rebellion against Wall Street is going. We got neocons trying to run it on the Republican Party. We've got the Democrats trying to take it over with George Soros, MoveOn.org. With more on that, we're joined by Darren McBreen.
Thanks, Alex. The leftist Democratic Party front, MoveOn.org, is set to hijack the Occupy Wall Street protest this week, which is pretty ironic given the fact that the Obama administration is a creature of Wall Street itself. Now, we're standing here in front of City Hall in Austin, Texas, just days before the Occupy Austin protest are set to take place. We wanted to get the public's opinion on this protest movement and see who they feel is behind it all.
Well, I think it's interesting. I mean, we don't have a whole lot of demonstrations happening in the United States, as far as I know, and this one seems to be a pretty big one. So it's nice to see people coming together and fighting for something they believe in.
It's people who are upset with the financial situation, with the bank bailouts, with the lack of repercussions.
I think the bankers are getting way too greedy.
People talking about freedom, ending the Federal Reserve, talking about the crimes committed by Ben Bernanke and other people in the high echelons of our government.
Not sure what their objective or goal is, except I've heard they're against corporate greed. Well, so is everybody. So what is the point, really? I don't understand.
I think it's very significant. I think we as a people have to pay attention to movements like this, because what it says is that folks are feeling disenfranchised and they're feeling like their government and their leaders aren't representing them.
Where do you think Obama stands on the Occupy Wall Street protests?
Well, that's interesting. One of the things I was trying to find myself this morning was whether or not I could figure out who was behind this. And my first thought was the Democratic Party. I'm a Democrat, and I support Obama, but I was just curious as to what, generally what's going on.
Obama is a corporate puppet. He opposes the people. He is for arresting and pepper spraying all these protesters you see in New York that are unlawfully being detained and arrested.
I mean, in terms of whether he supports Wall Street, I mean, it's hard not to when you're...